Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming and listening to my presentation. My name is Yoshiaki Komoria of SecurityFriday.com. Today, I'm going to talk about how we can exploit Beacon.Here is the agenda of today's presentation. First of all, I will start with some background information on COM and DCOM technology. Then,I will demonstrate our tools for exploiting Internet Explorer. After this demonstration, I will reveal some technical details, which including implementation and source codes. Authentication is a very important topic in this presentation because it is a main keyTo successful exploit. Then I will show the Microsoft Word exploit demonstration as another case of DCOM exploit. Let me start by explaining COM and DCOM technologies.DCOM, Distributed COM, is an application-level protocol for object-oriented remote procedure call. It is useful for constructing applications on distributed computing environments. Microsoft states, DCOM is a seamless evolution of COM. That means we can use COM components.On distributed computing environments. This is a COM model. When some program wishes to use COM components, it calls the interfaceprovided by COM components. The original COM model is for the local PC only. Client programs can only call components that are on the local PC. Microsoft extended COM as DCOMTo develop distributed application using COM components. This slide shows the distributed application model by using DCOM. In distributed applications, client programs can call COM components on remote PC.In the DCOM model, DCOM runtime provides a transparent interface to the client program. The client programs can call the components as if the components were on the local PC. Almost all Windows have DCOM runtime installed by default. This includes Windows XP, 2K98 and ME. However, DCOM is not enabled by default on Windows 98 and Windows ME. Microsoft says Windows NT have DCOM runtime. However, when I experimented on default NT, DCOM didn't work. Distributed COM configuration properties can be changed by running DCOM config exe. This can help us to change and set up COM properties, which include enabling or disabling DCOM support on local machine. And it shows DCOM enabled application list. Here is a list of COM components enabled to use of DCOM. As you can see, there are over 30 components configured as DCOM enabled applications. Here are some applications that are installed with Windows and set to use DCOM by default. From the list, you can see some programs such as Internet Explorer and Windows Media Player and more. Not only the applications from the above slides are by default DCOM enabled, but other applications such as Microsoft Office are too. Once they are installed, they are enabled to use DCOM. Those applications that show up in DCOM configs list are not all the DCOM enabled applications. You can look at a complete list of all the COM components on Windows. Run regedit exe and go to hkey classes root class ID. Almost all the components shown here are DCOM enabled without changing any configurations. The registry shows all the COM components which are represented by each key under hkey classes root class ID. As you can see, there are thousands of COM components. It wouldn't be an exaggeration to say that Windows is composed of COM components. Now I have finished the first part of my speech on COM and DCOM. I have also shown many applications that use DCOM. So, are we able to exploit and control these applications, such as Internet Explorer? If we can, to what extent can we control it? In a few seconds, I will do a demonstration. Do you know IIN? IIN is a tool we developed. I first introduced it on our website www.securityfriday.com a few months ago. The main purpose of this software is to reveal the security risk of DCOM. We do so by stealing Internet Explorer's transaction data and hijacking Internet Explorer's. One point to mention is that some antivirus programs have considered IIN as a Trojan horse. They will prevent IIN from starting up. Here is the basic working model for IIN. IIN on local PC. Okay. can connect to Internet Explorer on remote PC. Once they are connected, we can get browsing URL and browsing contents. Are you okay? once they are connected, we can get browsing URL and browsing contents, even those using SSL. We can also create a new window, change the browsing page, make a window invisible, and more. Here is the demonstration environment, a freshly installed Windows 2K on the remote PC. And another Windows XP on local PC. And left screen is remote PC. Right. Light か、sorry. Right screen is remote PC. Just a moment, please. I will set up my demonstration.Please look at right screen. There are three Internet Explorer windows. One of them shows the MSN Hotmail page. Please note that the remote Windows 2K Professional is clean without any extra programs. Now let me do the demonstration of Internet Explorer exploit.First, I will connect to the remote PC. I will enter IP address of remote PC. Next, I will enter username of currently logged on user on remote PC. 10Next, I will enter password. Then click OK. This is a window to access Internet Explorer of the remote PC. First, I will get list of browsing URL. Click down to see list. of browsing URL of remote PC. This. Next, I will get account and password for Hotmail. I will choose Hotmail window. Look at right screen. He will enter account and password for Hotmail and click sign in. Then you can see account and password for Hotmail. If you double click here, you can see details in a child window. The logon account is here and password. Finally, I will hide the window and show the window again. I will click invisible to hide the window of the remote PC. To show the window again, I will click visible. Let me repeat again. Click invisible, hide window. Click visible, show window. This concludes the demonstration. Let's go on to the next slide.
Are these two computers in the same domain?
Hi.
Are these two computers are in the same domain or in the same trust?
Computer,
両方同じ domain に入ってます。2つともドメインに入ってません。
Neither of them in the domain. They are not using domain.
Sorry, I can't hear.
In your exploit tool, you provided a set of credentials to connect to the target machine. Mm-hmm. Was that a local administrator on the target machine?
And I will explain about this in my presentation.
Okay.
I have just shown you some interesting but dangerous demonstrations exploiting Internet Explorer. It might seem very difficult to exploit Internet Explorer, but I will show you how easy it is to do so by explaining some technical details. This section is divided into two parts, stealing Internet Explorer's data and hijacking Internet Explorer. Let's start with stealing Internet Explorer's data. There are the topics for this section, and they will be talked about in this sequence. First, browsing URL list that you just saw in the demonstration. Second, incoming data. It is divided into two little subsections, cookies and HTML contents. Last, navigation events. Whenever Internet Explorer changes web pages, some events happen. IN will be able to get these actions and get and post parameters. I will start with browsing URL list. Internet Explorer has a COM interface named iWebBrowser2. We can steal Internet Explorer's data and hijack through this interface. I will talk about the steps and procedures involved in getting browsing URL lists and browsing URL lists on the remote PC. First of all, we need to activate a COM component called Shell Windows on the remote PC. There is very little information on Shell Windows in MSDN library, but this Shell Windows component provides interface to get iWebBrowser 2 of Internet Explorers. Once Shell Windows is activated, we can get iDispatch through iShell Windows. iDispatch is a COM interface on Internet Explorers. iShell Windows is a COM interface of Shell Windows components. It chooses which window to get when there are multiple Internet Explorer windows on the remote PC. iDispatch is the base interface of iWebBrowser 2. We need to get iWebBrowser 2, so we have to convert to iWebBrowser 2 from iDispatch. Then the URL strings can be obtained from iWebBrowser 2. This is a source code for activating Shell Windows. Important things to note is that we used course server info to get the IP address of the remote PC. And we used co-create instance X to first activate Shell Windows and second get iShell Windows interface. Here is the getting iDispatch source code. First of all, we need to get the number of Internet Explorer windows on the remote PC using iShell Windows. Then we get iDispatch interfaces from iShell Windows by using the item method. The first parameter is the number of Internet Explorer windows. Then we can use query interface method from iDispatch to get iWebBrowser 2 interface. Once we have acquired all the interfaces, we are ready to get URL lists on the remote PC. We simply call getLocationName method This method retrieves the name of the resource that Internet Explorer is currently displaying. Next, I will explain how to capture cookies and HTML contents. We need to use iWeb Browser 2 that we already acquired in the last section. To get cookies, we need to get iHTML document to interface from iWeb Browser 2, then call getCookie method of iHTML document 2. To get HTML contents, we need to get iHTML element interface from iHTML document 2, then call getOuterHTML method of iHTML element to get HTML contents. As you can see, the code to get cookie is very simple. To get iHTML document 2 from iWeb Browser 2, we call getDocument and queryInterface method. Once we have acquired them, simply call getCookie method. Getting HTML contents is very similar to getting cookies. Use getBody method from iHTML document 2 to get iHTML element. And then call getOuterHTML method to get HTML contents. Next, I will talk about navigation events. In order to get navigation events, we need to give Internet Explorer an interface. We implement an event handler on the client program, which provides an interface to Internet Explorer. Once Internet Explorer successfully obtains the interface, it can send events to the client program whenever an event happens. I will talk about the steps and procedures of getting navigation events. There is a dWeb Browser events interface that an application must implement in order to receive events from Internet Explorer. We have to create event handler implemented dWeb Browser events on our exploit application. Then we get iConnection Point interface through iWeb Browser 2 of Internet Explorer. The iConnection Point provides the function for the client to advise the interface of the event handler to the component. After that, we advise Internet Explorer through iConnection Point, where the event handler is. dWeb Browser events have several members to receive events. To get outgoing data, such as get and post parameters, we have to implement before navigate. This is a syntax of before navigate method of the web browser events. When browsing URL is changed, the Internet Explorer calls before navigate. The second parameter of this method is the URL to be navigated to. We can get new browsing URL with get parameters. And the fifth parameter of this method is the post data to send to the new URL. This is a source code for getting iConnection point. To get iConnection point interface, we call findConnection point method of iConnection point container interface. This is a source code for advising Internet Explorer. The class sync is an event handler implementing the web browser events. To advise Internet Explorer, we call advise method of iConnection point. Now I have finished the stealing Internet Explorer's data part. I will move on to hijacking Internet Explorer. Hijacking Internet Explorer can be divided into three sections. First, changing browsing pages. Second, making Internet Explorer windows invisible. Third, creating new Internet Explorer windows. This is a source code for changing browsing page. This is a very simple code. We just call navigate method and assign the first parameter as the new URL. To make Internet Explorer windows invisible, simply call put visible method from iWebBrowser2. Finally, create new windows. This is very similar to shell windows activation code. The only difference is the different usage on co-create instance X. We have to assign to the first parameter the type of component. In this case, it's class ID Internet Explorer. In the last section, I talked about exploit calls. However, I did not go through the authentication method. The only case that the exploit call from the last section will work is when the local PC and remote PC have the same user accounts. I will now talk about the authentication method. In this section, there are five main topics. In the first subsection, component activation procedures, I will explain what happens when a client program is trying to access to remote PC components. Second, two steps authentication. I will talk about the authentication mechanism that involves two steps. Third, event handling and authentication. I will talk about reverse authentication and why it happens. Next, exploit code. I will show the exploit code.And lastly, I will talk about a special case, Windows XP. I will start with component activation procedures. In DCOM, the component is protected by several security measures. The local PC needs to send the account information to the remote PC to activate remote components. DCOM can use several security protocols for authentication, such as Kerberos and NTLM-SSP. I will talk about remote component activation procedures using NTLM-SSP. First step, the local PC sends a NTLM-SSP negotiate message to system activator on the remote PC. System activator listens to port 135.NTLM-SSP is a challenge response type authentication protocol. Second step, the remote PC sends back a challenge code to local PC. Third step, the local PC will send a response code to remote PC.Fourth step,The local PC sends a request to remote PC to specify the desired component. Components are identified by class ID, and this message contains this class ID. Last step, the remote PC checks the local PC's account by using two-step authentication. If the account is valid,the remote PC sends back the result message. Next, I will talk about the two steps of authentication. Before the client program can activateComponents on the remote PC, it has to go through two steps of authentication. First, it has to pass the logon audit. Then the DCOM authentication. If both authentications succeed, client program can activate the componentOn remote PC. I will talk about logon audit and DCOM authentication details in the following slides. First, I will show failed logon audit. In this example, the remote PC has three users, Mike,Zeb and Joe. If the client program sends component activation request with account information of Bill, this request will fail because Bill is not available on the remote PC. This request is rejected by logon audit. Then successful logon audit case. This client calls remote, the client calls remote components with Joe's account. His account exists on the remote PC, so this request is successful. Next, I will explain the DCOM authentication. COM components have a launch and access control list. COM components also have run as property, which contains the user account used to launch and access the component. I will explain more about this in the next few slides. After a logon audit, the system will attempt to access the components using account setting by run as parameter. At the same time, components have the access control list, which is used to decide what account has permission to access to these components. If account setting by run as parameter is not found in access control list, this attempt to access to component fails. COM components have default settings for access control list, and run as parameter has default setting. Setting for access control list are system administrators and interactive users. Interactive user means the user that is currently logged on locally. And run as parameter is a launching user by default setting. Launching user is whoever passed logon audit. Therefore, if we can remotely log on as interactive user, we can launch and access this component. These default settings are also used by Internet Explorer and other components. So, to exploit Internet Explorer, we need to remote log on as the locally log on user's account. I have already talked about the component activation procedures, but in the case of event handling, the roles of client and server are reversed. Activation procedures are quite similar, but there are still some differences. In the case of event handling, the client programs provides an interface to receive events from components on the remote PC. When components try to connect to this interface, two steps of authentication will happen in the same sequence. This slide explains reversed roles of client and server. In this case, remote PC sends account information to the client's local PC. The local PC authenticates this account using logon audit and DCOM authentication. If authentication is successful, the component can connect to the client's event handler interface. To receive events, we need the same account on local PC. I have talked about the authentication mechanism of DCOM. Now I will talk about the exploit codes using IIN as the example. Before showing the code, I will explain the procedure. First, create a new account on the local PC. This account must be the same as the locally logon user on the remote PC. Second, run the exploit code with the new account's privilege. This is a source code for setting an account on local PC. First of all, create user info structure and set user info parameters, which include the username and password that the user wishes to create. After we have completed user info structure, we call net user add method with user info as one of its parameters. After we have created an user account, we need to create a client process. We can create a client process by using create process with logon double method. However, the same techniques cannot be applied to Windows XP, because the new security model is implemented. All network logon users are treated as guests by default. Usually, many system resources, such as COM components, are not available to guests, so we cannot exploit Windows XP. I will explain this again with this slide. If the client sends the account information to remote PC, and this account is available in remote PC, the logon audit is successful. However, the component is run as guest user due to the new security measure. Default Internet Explorer's access control list doesn't contain guest. Therefore, we cannot exploit it. However, we can exploit Windows XP by setting back to use the classic security model. To change the setting, we go to Control Panel and open Local Security Policy. Moreover, there is additionally a method of disabling the simple file sharing function. When this function is disabled from the tool menu of Windows Explorer, the classic security model is used automatically. If the security setting on XP has changed back to the classic model, we can exploit XP just like Windows 2K. Next, I will be doing another short demonstration of by exploiting Microsoft Word with the same techniques.I wrote Microsoft Word exploit program named Trojan Office. Here is a basic working model for this tool. My exploit program will activate Microsoft Word on remote PC and get list of recent document file names of Microsoft Word on remote PC. Then I will open the document and change this document. The demonstration environment is the same as before. Just a moment, please.I will set up my demonstration. Okay, he will create one document on remote PC and write message. DCOM is wonderful. Yes, he created one document. First, I will connect to the remote PC.I will enter IP address and username and password. Sasaki to Daimajin. Then click OK.This is a window to access Microsoft Word on the remote PC. Here is a list of recent files. I will read the document titled Exploit Doc. DCOM is wonderful. Next, I will show you how to change the document.I will write down new message. Office is Trojan. Hatena. Question. And click save. Okay. And click save.Please look at this, that screen. He will open the file, so this document is changed. For my last section, I will talk about how to defend ourselves from being exploited. I will show three methods to prevent DCOM exploit. First, filter port 135. That is used by DCOM. But this port is used by many other applications. So there is a risk that some application cannot work. Second, disable DCOM. We can disable DCOM by using DCOM config exe. However, this method disables all DCOM applications. Third method, use a strong password. If possible, I recommend it using passphrase rather than simple password. Let's review. I reviewed the risks of DCOM with exploit demonstrations. Next, I showed the DCOM exploit techniques with source codes. Finally, I explained how to defend ourselves from being exploited. I think Microsoft should inform users the risks of DCOM, as you saw in my demonstrations. And we can disable DCOM, but it will disable all DCOM applications. Therefore, Microsoft should provide simple interface for users to enable and disable each DCOM component. Over. はい、どうしてくれますか。
脆弱性だとは言ってない。
I didn't say it for a bit.
Microsoft の仕様です。仕様スペック。
This is a spec or specification of Microsoft by default. It's not necessary for an ability. That's what it is. Anything else?
Go to that screen, classic security model.
終わりでお願いします。
If you have any detailed questions, they are